Now, clearly one can never put a price on the loss of life or the degradation of health, but there is a big cost attached to the damage that's being caused in the wake of the tragedy that unfolded in Japan on the 11th of March this year with that earthquake and the ensuing tsunami, and of course what's happened subsequently to the nuclear industry in Fukushima plant, particularly around that particular area of Japan. But for those looking at Japan, or perhaps maybe even be in Japan at the moment in terms of investments, what now? Where do we go from here? Well, we're pleased to introduce our guest today, who is in from Henderson Global Investors, Michael Woodmartin, who runs a Japanese equities fund. Welcome.
Thank you.
What an exciting time potentially for investors. Clearly, as I said at the beginning, there's a big tragedy that's unfolded here, and there are a lot of people that have suffered dreadfully as a result of this. But let's stick with the opportunities on the business, right, the investment side.
True.
Where do we sit?
Well, ultimately now the market has retraced back to levels that it bottomed out at in 2003 and then in 2009. The market and the economy have been making fairly decent progress before the earthquake struck, but the earthquake has served to bring the market, you know, back down to these levels whereby investors have made good money beforehand from these low levels back in 2003 and in 2009. So we already have, shall we say, prices back down. We have asset support in terms of price to book back to 1x, again a level where the market has bottomed out. And more interestingly, I think that we have dividend yield support as well for the marketplace, whereby the dividend yield on the market is now slightly higher than the S&P. And more importantly, some of the big blue chip names in the equity market are yielding between 3% and 4%. And those dividends are well covered. So I think at this point in time, it's a very good time for investors to look at the Japanese equity market for potential investment.
As a fund manager, what are you doing now? How are you positioning yourself? What are you looking for in terms of sectors and companies even?
Ultimately, before the earthquake and disaster happened, I was on the recovery track, so therefore I was very much skewed towards the domestic economy, which by and large had lagged other economies around the world because Japan hadn't really, you know, instilled that boost that other economies had received. So the Japanese economy was recovering slowly after the global financial crisis, but it was recovering. We had an uptick in advertising spend and the such like, so you could see that the domestic economy was making some form of recovery. And that's where I was, that's where my portfolio was biased towards. Needless to say, after the earthquake hit, that was fairly negative for the domestic economy, so my fund has suffered a bit.
But what sort of losses did you make? What are you talking about here? I mean, just really for people viewing this who have investments in Japan, so that they can feel as though they too have shared in this.
Yeah, because it was the market was very quick in reacting to the earthquake. I think over a period of 2 to 3 days, it fell by more than 20% from top to toe, so it was really quick. And it's by and large, it's also bounced since then, and it's maybe got back about half of the losses that it suffered. So it was a nasty fall, but it was quick. So from here on in, I think that we can, you know, hopefully look to make some gains. But from my aspect, I'm really just looking for more domestically focused companies where I think that having suffered a setback, of course, there is greater upside potential.
I mean, we saw about 20% was taken off the main market, I think, wasn't it? But companies like TEPCO, yes, the power company, Tokyo Power Company, 70% down.
Yes.
And I mean, it's not really recovered either.
It's difficult for TEPCO because ultimately they were in extreme position.
Of course.
And it's interesting to see what's going to happen to TEPCO. I didn't have any investment in TEPCO. I don't have any utility companies per se.
Right.
Largely because I don't like the way the balance sheets are structured. They're heavily indebted. Quasi-government body, not great returns on capital, and therefore not very attractive from my point of view.
Right.
But TEPCO itself, I think, will take some time to recover in terms of stock price. Mm. And it may well be that other utility companies are asked to, shall we say, muck in and help TEPCO out in their hour of need. Mm. So ultimately, I think the utility sector overall will probably be under something of a cloud going forward in terms of investment.
Sure. One of the interesting numbers I know everybody's waiting for, and it's interesting talking to you now, because we saw that number out just recently from Toyota, a 77% drop in fourth quarter numbers, which included this dreadful period. But there's some interesting comments here, and we do have this recovery now in the parts and the supply chain, don't we, for parts?
Yeah, I guess the two big differences between Fukushima and the Kobe earthquake of 1995 is really the power supply and the supply chain disruptions. Those are two big factors which differ this time around and were much more disruptive to the economy. On the kind of the power side and the power supply side, while the headline figures, and initially there was great fear that there'd be brownouts and blackouts across Japan, that's not going to be the case. And you know, the Japanese, the way they are, they can rejig things, and they're very good at doing these things post-disasters. and therefore I don't think that the power situation is going to be much of an issue. I think there'll be maybe some brownouts, some people run their air conditioners at a slightly higher level. But that's one good factor, that they're recovering that more quickly. And on the supply chain side of things, again, it looks like companies have been fairly conservative in their forecasts in terms of getting back up and running. It looks like those plans will be brought forward. So, you know, in aggregate, I think that the outlook for the economy and activity to recover is perhaps better than we first thought. So that's encouraging.
Certainly, I mean, this backs up a report we had from Goldman Sachs saying that things are slightly better than some had feared. But in fact, I think you have got quite a positive outlook, haven't you, for the parts supply business? And in fact, people are originally talking about the back end of the year, when it's fully repaired. But you think it's going to be?
I think it'll probably be a bit quicker. I think we're seeing the worst of things now in terms of economic data. I think quarter two and quarter three of this calendar year will be pretty poor. But by quarter four, I think we'll be well on the recovery track. So again, we've taken a hit as we sit here now, because by the time we have the figures reported to us, we'll have moved on. So I think we're now really at the worst, or approaching the worst for the bad news on the economy, and that we can look forward then to the fourth quarter and next year for a strong recovery in economic activity.
I mean, you've been in this business quite some time. And in fact, you saw the markets rise sort of 39,000 back in the late 80s, didn't you? So to some degree, you've seen it all. Yeah. And we're now here, 8,500, almost 9,000 for the Nikkei. Where do we go? What's happening? What's the backdrop?
Well, I was around. I joined in 1987, so I saw the peak just at 39,000. And then I saw it all the way down, and here we are, just under 10,000. I think there's such a marked change in corporate behaviour, now as against then. And as I mentioned, you've got companies selling very cheaply, even dividend yield support, asset price support, and even price to earnings support once you normalise earnings, which should be the case over the next couple of years. The market is trading on a multiple which is very similar to other developed markets. So of all the stigma that Japan has attracted over the years as being a suffering deflation and the such like, I think that's by and large over, and people should look at Japan now in a more favourable light. And again, investor flows haven't been great to the Japanese market over the past number of years. Domestic retail investors haven't been in the marketplace, and they're very important for the market to perform. And I think once confidence returns to the economy, I think that people will begin to look at the equity market again, and that flows can recover, and with it, the equity market should perform.
So what's the message then for those investors that have suffered like you have suffered, and for those looking to start thinking about Japan?
I think for long-term investors in Japan, they should certainly stick with it and maybe perhaps look to add to positions. Because again, Japan has mimicked some of the rise over the past couple of years that we've seen elsewhere, like in the US and the UK markets, but nothing near the same magnitude. And post this earthquake, of course, we've been knocked back. So I still think you're getting a very solidly valued marketplace at a decent price. So I think for existing investors, you should certainly stick with it and perhaps add to it. And for investors who aren't involved in Japan now, I think now's a very good time to do some work on investment in the Japanese market.
Just one final question. What about the strong yen? I mean, it has affected some companies, hasn't it? The export potential.
It certainly has, yeah. There's no question about that. But the Japanese are quite good at managing a strong yen. What they don't like is a rapidly appreciating yen. And I think that we've had some intervention at around the 80 yen dollar level by the G7. I would hope that we kind of maintain this level or thereabouts. And once you maintain a level, I think corporate Japan can cope with that quite well. We don't want to see, of course, as the yen shooting off towards 70 and beyond. That will be very disruptive. But I think at these levels, I think corporate Japan can cope.
Can cope with it. Okay, all right, Michael, thanks. Very interesting, certainly an interesting time for Japanese investors. That's Michael Woodmartin there from Henderson Global Investors.
This film is for educational and leisure purposes only. Proactive Investors does not provide investment advice. The company is a publisher and is not registered with or authorized by the Financial Services Authority. Please refer to the full terms and conditions on the Proactive Investors website.